Ladies and gentlemen, before we break for lunch, we have one more short but interesting session on voice biometrics. The speaker is familiar to you, Mr. Lishoy Bhaskar, who is the Vice President of MobMe Wireless Solutions Private Limited. He also heads the government business unit in MobMe and is an expert in mobile governance and mobile-based security solutions. Over to you, Mr. Lishoy.
I know everybody is waiting for lunch, but I'll just take 10 more minutes to explain something interesting to you. Yes, today, for example, what is commonly used for identification of especially criminals is primarily fingerprints. So fingerprints have been there for quite some time. We have automatic fingerprint identification system, which is AFIS, deployed across the country. And I believe in CCTNS as well, we will have the same thing to be plugged. So if you look at a global scenario, the new emerging trend in this field is nothing but voice biometric. So I have a voice which is not there for anyone else. So there are some unique features or factors in my voice which will actually tell a system that, hey, this is Lishoy and that is Madam Srilekha or that is Sir Vincent Paul. So this voice biometric is all about creating a voice identity for each and every individual. So how do we do it? And talking about the technology, this has proved to be far superior compared to your fingerprints, because fingerprints have often failed. Even the latest few projects which have been announced by DIT and others, we have seen that there have been debates about these technologies, especially fingerprint. So if you look at in the UK, there are few banks which use voice for your access. For example, now I call up on an IVR system and says, hey, this is Lishoy. That is my bank password to begin my transactions. And speech-to-text application is something. For example, now in the high courts and the Supreme Court, they are using a technology called speech-to-text. When the judge is actually, so which is again, cut short the time period which it takes to actually give a paper in hand. So what needs to be done for, to create voice biometric? As far as law enforcement agencies are concerned, what you basically need 60 seconds of a person's speech to create a voice identity for that person. So the next time, so imagine we have the system in place. So whenever there is an interrogation happening or an investigation happening, you're questioning somebody, all that you need is a small device which is called as a dictaphone. That dictaphone will actually capture your voice. And it will convert, it is connected to a system. That system will, within seconds, convert this into your voice identity, which is your voice biometric. And so another example that I would like to quote is, so we have, I'm seeing police departments, other agencies across the country coming out with tenders for call interceptors. Now you intercept calls, you have millions of calls being intercepted. But what is of my interest is to see if X, Y, or Z is talking over any network in India. So how do you actually pick on that particular person? There are technologies available today. For example, now you have my, so the system has Lishoy's biometric. So the system is configured such that 1,000 criminals, these are the 1,000 criminals, if they talk in India, I want that to be alerted to my system within seconds. So these technologies are available today, and MHA is currently working on this direction. They have recently come out with a similar tender that I'm told. And so I was talking about this technology to a couple of officers here. So they were asking me, so what if a mimicry artist comes and mimics my voice? Or for instance, I have a recorder which is the best recorder available in the world, and I record your voice and I play into the system. So there are, if you look at the last sentence, physical and behavioral factors combine to produce unique voice patterns, which is there are about 100 features or 100 characteristics of for any individual's voice. No matter how good a person in mimicking your voice or however good the system or your recording system is, all that your system can get is maximum 5 factors right. So even if I'm having a cold, the system will identify, you will still identify me. Because in some system, when banks consider voice biometrics for their password, what if somebody's, you know, holding me at a gunpoint and ask me to talk over the phone? The system will identify that I am in distress. So the technology and R&D is gone so deep that the technology is proven, it has been used across the globe, especially in the West. So if you look at, you know, the roadmap, what has to be done in this direction, first is to collect a database, or you need to create voice samples of those citizens who are of your importance, especially for law enforcement agencies. The next is to monitor. So now you have a database of, say, 1 million people in India for whom you have a voice sample. The next thing what you need to do is to monitor if these people are talking in India. So you have your systems in place. Those systems will intelligently pick if X, Y, or Z is talking. And these systems can even identify languages and dialects. For example, now you have we have our Prime Minister for India coming to Trivandrum. Now, we want to ensure 100% security in this. Now, we are intercepting all the calls in, say, in a 10-kilometer radius in Trivandrum. Now, I want to see if anybody is talking in, you know, any other foreign language, may it be Arabic, Urdu, Hindi, or, you know, it's easier to pick on people. So the system will actually give me the information. If somebody is talking in any other language other than Malayalam, they'll be flagged, and the information will be given to the control room. So if our operators actually join hands with the department, we can even get the cell ID from which they are talking. So all that you need is a location-based information coming in from your telecom operator. The next is definitely to identify. So now you have the voice of a particular person. The next thing that you do is pick them on a call conversation. So similarly, it can identify what gender. So if it is a girl talking or a boy talking or a man talking or a woman talking, language recognition, any language. So currently, technology is available to support about 22 international languages and some dialects, even in Hindi. The system is so mature or capable, it can even understand dialects. For example, in Kerala, the Malayalam that we talk in this part of the state is different from what is being spoken in Kasaragod. So the system has matured. It is still, you know, in R&D, but there are agencies who are currently using this. So if you look at, you know, kidnappers, organized criminals, terrorists, drug traffickers, it is so once you get them on into your custody, you can easily create a voice sample, and the next time, anywhere in the globe, anywhere, it is currently being used by some border control, some immigration agencies. So you have a database of international criminals. So if they fly anywhere through any of the airports, you want to check, because the immigration officer is anyway striking a small conversation with the person who is coming in. So he can easily pick using his voice ID. So key features, accurate identification. There are, you know, technologies evolved so that you have millions of voice samples from which you can easily pick those people who are of your interest. And definitely the mobility, because unlike office, where you need fingerprint scanners to be installed in all your premises, here you don't need anything. All that you need is a small system, which is just as small as a mobile phone. And it is done on 11 kilohertz, you know, recording. So you cannot do it over the phone, but you need somebody in front of you to do this. So this is the next emerging thing as far as, you know, biometrics is concerned. I hope the officials out here will definitely give it a thought and, you know, consider in law and order and policing. I think that's all. Thank you. Yeah, shoot. It is still, before the questions are being sought, I would just like to take this. It is still a technology which has been developed, and R&D is still in that direction. Yeah.
It's difficult to connect a voice to a crime. Like fingerprint, you can lift it from a scene of crime and then connect it to the particular person.
Yes.
But from a scene of crime, you cannot lift a voice unless you have a recording system somewhere.
Absolutely.
Installed in the
Definitely,
house.
Ma'am. So this is only for recording purpose. So it is mostly used
for
your
identity.
Yeah, identity. So you want to see if ex-criminal is in Kerala, or NIA has a database of 1,000 criminals. If you want to see if any of those guys are talking over, you know, in the state of Kerala using any of the telecom networks, because that will be of your interest. Because this will mostly handle, you know, the next level of problems.
This, I think the technology must be in a very incipient stage, because we have been talking a lot about iris technology, you know, identification. But I have visited NatGrid office, and it took me 10 minutes, you know, to get my iris photographed, you know. And it has not happened once, it has happened thrice, you know. So it is very easy to say that we have so many technology, but translating that technology into the action is a very,
definitely,
I think we
ma'am.
Have to go very far.
Definitely.
Far,
for example, this has been used outside by a lot of security agencies.
No, which are the security agencies? You give us the names.
It has been used in the UK. And
I mean,
if
no,
I
you have to be specific.
No, I'll not be able to take out the names.
No, because
but
it is very easy to say that it has been used there and it has been used there.
I'll give you references of banks.
But when you find it out in actuality, you will not find. They'll say, oh, we are still in the research stage, isn't it?
Yes.
Hello? Yes.
Yeah. Go
you
ahead.
Mentioned that there are almost 200 features in a voice sample.
Right. Right.
But no recorder is able to capture more than 5 features.
5. Yeah. This is what the techies tell me.
Then
sorry.
How? Then at maximum, whatever system you put in place, your recorder will only work on 5 features.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
If the input processing mechanism can only capture 5 features, then your system is working only
when
on 5 features.
When you're mimicking, see, when I'm talking, the other side gets my modulation. However you record, the modulation goes differently.
So you mean to say, if you put a tape recorder, then it's exactly duplicate?
No, it is not. A tape recorder's voice and a human speaking is two different things. And you can check the modulation. You can record my voice and play it on two different systems. I can explain to you offline. But this is proven.
I seriously doubt that.
We'll talk. Yes, sir.
Okay, you said this is a developing technology. What is the rate of false positives that you have as of now? Can it be really practical to use this? Because if it's going to be, you know, 3 or 5 attempts, like the lady said, if it's going to take 5 attempts to actually use this or authenticate this in a real world scenario, you can't be tracking this, right? You can't be using it for tracking. You have millions of transactions. You will not have 5 attempts to actually get this person criminal talking before you actually identify. So I think the rate of false positive is going to make a big difference. What's it?
So I would definitely advocate this technology, because see, I am not a techie myself, but what I've read and what my R&D people have been telling me, or my counterparts in the US and the UK have been telling me, that this is far superior, definitely, and it is being used by banks, by those high net worth individuals for identification. If it is used by high net worth individuals to do millions of transactions, which means it is definitely safe. But definitely when it comes to India, our officers, our policy makers will have to give it a thought and see if it fits our country and our requirements.
There any more questions?
He's here to kill me. Yeah, go ahead.
We always hear that this solution is the best one, this solution is the best one. I have just a example. The Britain has put biggest amount of cameras per person on earth.
Who?
UK, Great Britain.
Yeah.
But in the 5-year testing phase, they have never identified a single criminal.
To be honest, it is not about the technology. It's about what you deploy. It's about the tenders which come out. It's about what are the specifications of the tender. So it is not about the technology. Technology is still available there. It is about what is being deployed.
That system passed 100% in the testing phases.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying.
It was perfectly fine.
When you go for a practical implementation of any technology for that matter, you know, I have a technology which is working brilliantly. Now I go to a department and say, hey, department, this is what I have to offer you. They'll tell me, okay, let me float a tender. Now, it all depends on the specifications in the tender. Okay, so they might not end up buying exactly what they want to buy. There are a lot of factors. So if it is like a private company blindly entrusting me with a piece of work, I can assure it. But it's not about the technology, it's about the implementation. As far as government and law enforcement agencies are concerned, what I have seen is these are not technological challenges. These are all always operational challenges. So that's a problem about it. I don't think there's any problem with the technology.
Boss, you told that it'll be useful for the immigration officer to catch a criminal once he enters the airport. How will it be useful for the immigration officer to catch hold of him?
So you have a database.
Correct. No, how many such database will the immigration officer will have then?
So you don't need a database. All you have is a small dictaphone. Now I find, okay, there is something suspicious about somebody. I do a, you know, a small chat. Where are you coming from? What are you doing? So the system will immediately connect with the master database and it will scan and come back to me and say, hey, I've found somebody. That's how it works.
I think we should continue the rest of the discussion over lunch.
Offline.
Thank you, Mr. Lishoy Bhaskar.
Thank you very much
for introducing us.
Once again.
And
thank you.
Thank you so much for introducing us to that technology.